I was just thinking that there's a famous verse in the Gita that we'll look at. Karpanya dosho upahata sobhava kuchyam tomangana sambhuta cheta yachraya syamis chicham buhitam e shishaste ham shadhi man tvam prapanam. Is it? This verse is, it represents a rasa sanghi, or a change in the relationship between Krishna and Arjuna. Arjuna says that karpanya dosha, because of a fault of weakness of character or miserliness. Upahata svabhava, because I become affected by this fault of weakness of character. Then dharma samudha cheta, I'm asking you, Arjuna, dharma samudha cheta, I'm bewildered. My mind is bewildered about what's my dharma. Prachami Tvam, I'm asking you because my mind has become bewildered about what my dharma is. So I'm asking you because I've become bewildered about what my dharma is as a result of having a lack of care. Yachraya syam nischitam buhitame. So please tell me definitively what will be the best for me. Please tell me definitively what will be best for me. Shishasteham, I am your disciple. Shadimam, instruct me. Tvam prapanam, I'm surrendering you, I'm approaching you. In the mood of the disciple, please instruct me. I'm asking you what will be best for me, because I've become bewildered about what my dharma is as a result of a lack of integrity. Big verse, right? You can see it's a chain, right? So in the beginning of the Gita, Arjuna is arguing with Krishna. And then at a certain point, in the beginning of the second chapter, after having exhausted his arguments and getting it all out, he then speaks this verse. And really, the Gita begins a couple of verses from now, where Krishna begins instructing Arjuna spiritually. Whereas previously, he was just going back and forth, they're having a little conversation from the point of view of politics or mundane ethics, but the conversation moves into a silent spiritual tone. Just a couple of verses. Krishna begins to speak the Gita. So, what I thought was interesting about this verse is that Arjuna is showing vulnerability and weakness, and he's showing a chink in his armor, and he's admitting he doesn't know everything. He's admitting he's got issues. And that is a core piece if you want to connect with somebody. People spend a lot of time trying to make it seem like they've got it all together. But who's got it all together? How can you relate to somebody who's got it all together? If you've got issues, and the person you're talking to seems like he has no issues. Do you follow? And so it's counterintuitive, but we think, oh, I'm going to put my best foot forward, I'm going to show my best side. But actually, your best side is your real side, your vulnerable side, you open with what you struggle with. It's subversive, it's counterintuitive. But by opening with your issues, you let the other person know, I don't think I'm better than you. I've got issues too. Here's what I'm struggling with. And then instead of it being some kind of like a mutual chest thumping session, by approaching the other person in a mood of humility, usually if the person's evolved, A, they'll feel empathy for you and compassion and want to understand you. And B, they usually share a piece of their heart too. So Arjuna does this to connect with a teacher. It's the preceptorial fee. It's the price of getting a good teacher. It's this kind of openness that we forget that a good teacher might be rare, but a student's even rarer. And this is the right mood of a student. It becomes really easy to teach a student right. I'm aware of my faults. I'm aware that you can help me with my faults. And I'm looking for you to tell me. Now, if you're going to fill this in just a little bit, but ultimately Krishna says to Arjuna, yata ichasi tadahu. Whatever you like, that you should do. At the end of the year. The truth is, we have to fly our own plane in this world. The truth is that people can't make our decisions for us when we're adults. And that's not just because you're the smartest guy in the room. There may be people who are a lot smarter than you. But nobody knows you as well as you know yourself. You can share everything. People can kind of know you better than you know yourself, maybe in certain areas, in certain respects. But ultimately, you've got all the day-to-day info. Going back to the day you were born, so. And so you, part of being an adult, part of being a grown-up is carrying a burden. What is that sound? What's that sound?
A tree fell
on
the street.
Oh,
okay. Thank you.
That's what it sounds like, the chainsaw. All right. I think being an adult is acknowledging that you are responsible for making all of your life decisions and the weight of them rests squarely on your shoulders. And in many ways, being a child is not being able to accept that responsibility and having parents that are a buffer between you and that ultimate responsibility. Even if you go to a surgeon and you ask him, what kind of surgery should I do? And you ask him, you know, if it was your kid, would you do the surgery? If it was you, what would you do? If there's different options. Well, you have to pick the surgeon, right? Choose not to get a second opinion or to get one. Frame your question now. And ultimately, if you decide to do what the surgeon tells you, they make you sign. You ever gone for surgery? It's the whole thing. Like I got my right knee done. I need my ACL done on my right knee. And so they start making you sign stuff. So I'm operating on the right here today, is that correct? Like, okay, sign that, you have to sign me. Have you seen it, like, multiple times? That multiple times I've been sign stuff on the part of the body that I'm operating. Because, I mean, you know, they scope you, and it's like they pick the wrong knee because they forgot. So they involve this, you know, they do a Six Sigma thing. Six Sigma is a principle in manufacturing where if you check something six times, you get down to 3 mistakes per million. You have 6 sets of eyes to check a single aspect of manufacturing, then the result is you'll make only 6 mistakes out of a million. We have 7 Sigma, which is even more. 6 Sigma used to be the gold standard. I think maybe 7 Sigma is now. But they put these multiple redundancies in there to make sure you're not making a mistake. They also make sure you're taking responsibility for the surgery they're doing on you, because it's ultimately your decision to let them cut. You get it? So, part of being an adult, and really, I'm going to say part of it, I'm going to say the essence of being an adult is the shift from somebody else is responsible for what I do in my life to I'm responsible for what I do in my life. And just because you take on guides and mentors, it does not exonerate you from the responsibility of choosing carefully who those guides are, and then ultimately deciding what you want to do with the advice you're given. Henry Ford sued somebody for slander. I think they called him an idiot or something like that. And so the court case, and they brought witnesses in to ask him math questions, stuff that he would be able to answer to show that he wasn't that smart. And Henry Ford said, I might not know the answer to that, but I can make a phone call and have people here in 10 minutes who will be able to answer your question. And he won the slander suit. So, at least that's an anecdote I heard. I didn't know if it's true or not. It's an anecdote I heard. I gotta Google it to make sure it's true. You know this, have you ever heard this, if you're depressed, you're living in the past. If you're anxious, you're living in the future. And if you're peaceful, you're living in the present. You heard that one? Usually attributed to Lao Tzu, but that's not from him. The earliest version they found that is from 2009. You got that, you got to check everything, you know? You got to check everything. I think the move from childhood to adulthood is the acceptance of full responsibility for all your decisions in life. And that can then involve going and finding experts to help you. But ultimately, you have to choose who the experts are, whether you're going to follow their advice, and how you're going to follow their advice, how much information you give them. I remember I was asking one of my gurus for some advice one day, and he goes, well, based on what you've told me, this is my advice, that if there are things you haven't told me, then I won't be able to give that advice to confidence. Interesting, right? Rather than what you've told me. Based on what you told me, here's my take. If there are elements of the issue you haven't told me yet, then that might change my opinion. It's very pragmatic, right? Because Marjorie parachutes in once a year, we spend 4 or 5 hours together trying to download everything I've gone through. And I ask them for advice, trying to be a respectful disciple. How much information can I really give them in that short period of time? I can try to update them as best as possible. But he's always careful to give me some caveats with his advice, some disclaimers with his advice. Virabhadra Maharaj famously said, I was just talking the other day, 3 decades ago, told me, don't keep your guru in Maya. Don't keep your guru in Maya, which is a totally subversive and counterintuitive and downright strange thing to say. Don't keep your guru in illusion. How can you keep your guru in illusion? The whole idea of having a guru is something in your life not in illusion. What he meant was, if you willfully deceive your teacher, then the result of that willful deceit is that they don't have all the information they would need to be able to guide you. We're not attributing some kind of otherworldly omniscience to a teacher. They may have some incredible intuition or whatever, but another thing is, the kind of, you know, it's interesting, but I have 2 basic ways I advise people in life. One of them is, I assume that you're lying to me. I assume everything you say can be deceitful. And I get a certain, you know, it doesn't mean I'm assuming that it is deceitful. It could be deceitful. And so I'm fact-checking, claim-checking everything you come to me. And I'm honestly looking for the deceit. Trying to uncover the deceit. Maybe even so you can see it. Maybe you don't even know. But I'm walking into a situation assuming that everything the person says could be untrue. Either self-deceit or deceit purposefully directed towards me. To cover up, to front, to look better than you actually are, something like that. And there's a certain insight I have when I do that. I become good at spotting lies, and I become good at digging in and figuring out what makes people tick and what their issues are. I have a whole different way I deal with people who I have a high trust relationship with. I don't assume everything they're going to say is deceitful. I rather assume that everything they say, everything they think, they're going to tell me. And then my job becomes much more about helping them go to a very, very deep place where they can uncover deeper truths with the assumption that once those deeper truths are discovered, the moment they occur to them, they will share them with me. And I don't need to dig for truth with them. I just need to help them go to a deep place and guide them. But there's a high trust relationship where it's almost that they're going to give me a transparency where they're going to let me look in their heart and see what's really going on. And so I put down my guard of fact-checking and assuming that deceit is always an option. Did you follow that? And there's a distinction, a very, very sharp line of demarcation. And ultimately, it's a continuum as I build trust and relationship with somebody. But I can look at most people in my life and I can decide where they're leaning towards. And more than that, more like what bucket they're in. It's more like they're in the bucket. It's not even just a continuum. There's a little bit more of a sharp distinction between high trust people and low trust people in my life. No trust, I'm going to talk to you. Low trust and high trust. And I do my finest work in a high trust relationship where we can assume everyone's being fully honest and nothing's being willfully hidden. But if somebody's actually low trust, and I imagine they're high trust, I'm relatively easy to deceive because I'm not looking for deceit. Does that make sense? It's relatively easy to pull one over on me. Pull the wool over my eyes and get one over on me, I guess. I mix two idioms. So you can seek guidance after you've taken responsibility for your life. But that doesn't exonerate you from being responsible for having sought the right guidance, deciding if you're going to accept that guidance or not, bringing honesty to the equation. There's a lot of responsibility on the part of an adult who takes on a teacher. It's not disempowering. It's not giving up your independence. It's not giving up your freedom. In fact, it's a very expert understanding of your freedom and the responsibility that goes with it, and a willingness to admit that you don't know everything, and to be vulnerable, and to let other people help you elevate your game. And those people have to be chosen carefully, vetted carefully. And even their advice has to be respected. Don't keep your guru in mind. Based on the information you've given me, here's my advice. And Maharaj literally said to me, if there's information you haven't shared with me, it may change my advice. Real surrender and false surrender may externally look the same, but they're two very different things. Real surrender carries with it a responsibility, carries with it an honesty, carries with it a depth. False surrender is cheap. It's a sham. It looks shiny on the outside, it's gilded, there's nothing behind it. It's, gold plated. It's not solid gold. The teacher also becomes vulnerable, as does the student. There's vulnerability on both sides. To adopt somebody. We say the teacher accepts your karma as if it's some mystical process. There's a very practical sense in which your teacher accepts your karma because he agrees to stay with you and navigate your life with you and help you. There's a very practical sense in which the teacher takes on your karma because he now takes responsibility for helping you to navigate through your life. And you're not just left figuring everything out on your own and reinventing the wheel, but you have some expert guidance. Anyway, if you want to connect with people, you show some vulnerability. They empathize with you. They also let their guard down. It's a being of building trust. Everybody's got stuff that they're still working on. Everybody's got issues. And instead of hiding them, the real move is to show them. And great things happen from that. Even if you show your weak side, obviously if you're in prison and, since you're trying to steal your food, you don't want to show them your weak side. There are going to be circumstances, and the more animalistic, the more likely these circumstances are. There are going to be certain circumstances in life that you may go through where there is no room for showing any weakness whatsoever. Ideally, you don't want to be in those situations very often. Those situations have a high cortisol level attached to them. They're going to have adrenaline dumps attached to them. They're going to be dangerous. They're going to be violent. So the goal of life is not to stay in those buckets that often. Most of your life you should spend in a much more relaxed bucket. And that's a place where you should surgically explore being vulnerable with people. And then see what they do. See what they do. Admit fault. Apologize. Admit your weaknesses. Sometimes go overboard. Sometimes I even go overboard. Not in that fake way where, I'm so terrible. You're the best. But I really, it's super passionate. Not like that. That stuff is really cheesy. I accept that annoys me. Like anything. That's irritating. But sometimes I'll go big, like go extra with my apology or my acknowledgement of fault or my acknowledgement of my own shortcomings. And part of it's just because I'm okay with it. What's the big deal? So what? It's ultimately no skin off my back. But I'm also watching to see if the person does it. Sometimes you meet people and the more vulnerable you are, the more horrible they are. You ever meet people like that? I don't want those people in my life. That's like a great indicator for me to put some space between me and that person. You ever meet people like that? The more humble you are, the more open you are, the more genuine you are, the worse they get. Have you ever met people like that? Those people they go on the list. They're on me. I don't want to be too close to this. We can be acquaintances, not friends. You follow? Sometimes I meet people and you show vulnerability and they give you nothing in return. You ever meet people like that? They don't have the capacity to meet you with empathy or vulnerability themselves, right? Great. Those people aren't not going to be super close to you. Then sometimes you meet people where you're vulnerable to them, they're falsely vulnerable to you. You come at them genuinely and they come at you with something fake and cheesy and fake deep. And if you're deep, you can recognize this. Another great indication that person is not your peer, isn't capable of a deep relationship. And then once the blue moon, you come at somebody vulnerable with some depth, with some acknowledgement of shortcomings and fault, and they reciprocate. Either with empathy, and they show themselves to really be above you, just naturally, you see by their response, the higher vantage point, and they almost pick you up to their level. Or alternatively, they come back at you with some vulnerability of their own, and there's a real kinship. A real camaraderie. That's great. But without taking that step yourself, how are you going to discover those amazing people that you want to build life with? So this works across the board with friends, with spouses, between teachers and students. It works across the board. You show vulnerability, and that creates an opportunity for a more intimate, more real, more rewarding connection. And everybody starts to put their guard down, and the relationship becomes very progressive. Alternatively, the person is not capable of doing that, in which case, great. You're ready, you can move on to greener pastures. And just because you're approaching a teacher, just because you're looking for guidance, doesn't mean that you are giving up your responsibility. In fact, it's just the opposite. Really taking on a teacher demands a tremendous amount of honesty, integrity, demands a tremendous amount of vulnerability, it demands a tremendous amount of responsibility to search out that teacher, to test them appropriately, to make a decision whether to follow their guidance or not. That's what I got for you today. Karpanya dosha upata swabhava prachami tvam Dharma Samudra Chaita. Yatshreya. Yatshreya Sanishticha Mudita Me Shishasteham Shadi Mam Tvam Pratanam. I am bewildered by my Dharma because I'm suffering from a lack of integrity. I'm asking you to tell me what's the best thing for me to do in this situation? approaching you. I'm surrendering to you. I'm your student. Please give me guidance. That's a powerful, subversive, vulnerable, courageous way of looking for truth. And it embodies the beauty and the magic that's involved in leading with vulnerability. There's a magic in this idea. I'm going to lead with vulnerability. I was just thinking, Sri, first time I met Sri, she hit me with this fake vulnerability thing. I tried to connect with her in a real way. She was like still wiping in and out burger juice off her beard. And she said some dumb thing to me. Oh yeah, it's hard being a therapist because, like, you know, you meet people and you care, like, how much is like caring too much? And, you know, it's like unhealthy to like take on too much of a burden of your patients. Sounds good, right? But for whatever reason, the way she said it, her cadence, her tone, whatever it was, it just seemed so cheap. I said to her, I said that's, you're being fake deep with me. It sounds like you rehearsed that as a thing you break out to sound the light. Remember this? It was like right here. Yeah, right here. And then like standing on those steps. And then she goes, she starts, just like breaks down crying. It's like, and tells me about the super painful event that happened in her life when she was 15, that she never told anybody about up to that point, practice speaking. That she thought about every day, all day long, like her entire life was trying to not tell people about it. And now I was like, okay, this is something I can have a relationship with. Something real. Sometimes you get the people who cry on cue. That's also got to learn to recognize the difference between crocodile tears and real tears. You meet somebody and they get into a tough spot in the conversation and break down crying, and they see it's not working, they stop. they deploy, they kind of turn on the waterworks at regular intervals, and they think it might get them some purchase. And then if you don't react, you just turn them off just as quickly as you turn them on. And you realize you're not a really sophisticated deceiver. So, I'm trying to help you guys understand something about moving from low trust to high trust, the different types of mentality you bring to those relationships, how to start a relationship with somebody, what the typical reactions you might get when you try to start a deep relationship with somebody, what are the benefits, and I also want to troubleshoot and defend the idea that having a teacher does not mean you're giving up your independence or your personal responsibility. That was what I was trying to do today. And I was inspired by a verse in the Gita. Siyan nischita ruhita me shishasteham shadimam tvam prapana kapanya dosho Patasobhava Pajami from Dharma Samudha Chita. Okay, got the verse. Thoughts?
Point of
tonight. I said that the what it means to be an adult is to take full responsibility for your life and to admit the reality that you have to fly your own plane. That's your responsibility. That's, I've never said it quite like that before. And that being a child is not to do that. And the move from childhood to adulthood is an acceptance of full responsibility. I'd never framed it quite like that before. At least I don't believe I have. I might have, I just forgot, but I don't believe I've ever. I thought I had thought that tonight for the first time. Good, enough. More, yeah.
The way that you described seeking guidance as a true expression of your free will, I've never heard it explained that well. And I want to like record that. And I would struggle with that point. So, yeah, thank you.
Yeah. I think most of us are afraid that taking a teacher means giving up your free will. Or most of us are afraid of people who might criticize us for that. And so if you've internalized that critique, then you're going to make that critique yourself, of yourself, and you feel like you're disempowered, weak, and a cult member. Alternatively, you just don't know how to respond to that criticism. And so you find it like a vulnerability that you carry around with you and just waiting for a good cult buster to come along and point out that you're an idiot. And so I think the points I made are valuable two ways. Number one, they help you to internally do battle with your own inner atheist. And simultaneously, they help you deal with people who might make those critiques. Follow that? More? Yeah.
One of the things that has hindered me in being a better student and asking for guidance is the shame and embarrassment of feeling like a child to do those things and like I'm burdening my mentors. And today's class really helped me understand what's a way that's productive.
I don't think you're being honest. I don't think you're being willfully deceitful. But I think rather than saying you're ashamed, you're burdening your teachers, I don't think that's what it is. I think that you are afraid of looking like an idiot. And that's different than I don't want to burden you with my troubles. I don't want to burden you with my troubles is a pseudo, I'm worried about you. I don't look like an idiot is a lot more straightforward admission than it's selfish. Also, there's I'm not worthy, again, selfish and narcissistic, just the negative side of narcissism. And really, I'm not worthy, which is I don't want to waste your time, is really another way of saying, that's a covert way of saying I'm not worthy. And so I'm not worthy really means I don't think you care enough. And so it's actually a critique of the person you're avoiding because you think they don't care enough. And selfish. That's all about you. And so people don't not share their embarrassing troubles and skeletons because they're afraid of burning other people. Maybe you saw it on a TV show or something without sounding cool, so you borrowed it. But that's not the reason why people don't share. That's preposterous. The reason why people don't share is because they don't want to be humiliated. They don't want to be abandoned. They don't want to be betrayed. They don't want to be criticized. They don't want to be looked down upon. Doesn't that feel more authentic?
Yes.
Good. Who else? Yeah.
Thank you for this class.
And the reason I know that is because that's how I feel. So I know that's how other people are going to feel too, because how I feel. And I've heard so many times people say that, I don't want to disturb you. uniquely abysmal, you know, attempt to squeeze out from the stark reality of it. I've heard that many times, and thought of myself many times. Yeah?
My question is, so if you have a spouse, an immediate family member, or a lifelong friend that can't get themselves out of this lower tier bucket, how do you deal with that?
Down there. I mean, if your spouse is like that, that sucks. You have a family member or a lifelong friend? Yeah, it's like, who's got lifelong friends they don't really hang with? You just talk about, you know, how you used to play baseball together. Like, you know, every month you see them once a year, talk for an hour about old times, and you go your separate ways. Everybody's family members like that, and old friends like that are just in the acquaintance bucket, but they used to be in the friendship bucket, but then you went and got deep and they didn't, so it is what it is. You keep coming out of your vulnerability, and if they ever wake up and they'll meet you, you always have the door open. But you just walk away, you be authentic, and then authentic people will be attracted to you, and inauthentic people will just be repelled. Almost like a magnet, get repelled. You don't have to deal with them, you don't have to kick them out or do anything in particular. Just keep moving forward with your own life, stay vulnerable. And people who can't do that will just naturally fall. If you have a spouse like that, that sounds like a disaster. And the fact you mix all three together makes no sense to me. It's spoken like someone who's never had a spouse. More? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this was a really special class. Like, I never heard you explain the disciple group relationship in that way. Like, it left me feeling like this is the best choice I've ever made, is being a disciple of yours and Patricia Maharaj. It just made me think and reflect how I was big vulnerable when I came around. He even told me, I remember in the back of your faith. I've never heard someone say that before. And I used to always be afraid of being rejected. And I was worried that I couldn't give someone a chance to see that they made the wrong choice, you know. But being your student and being around a teacher whose level of reciprocity and just like the way you model those behaviors is so above me, but not in a way where I'm reminded that there's a power differential, where it's like I feel empowered to actually embody what you example.
Very kind. Your words are very kind. Yeah, you and I have a high trust relationship. It's funny when I was talking about high trust relationships. I thought in my mind as I was saying it, and it might just be because you're sitting directly in my line of vision, so I'm not going to make everybody else feel crappy, but I did think, yeah, I have a high trust relationship now with Mother. I thought that. I don't worry that you're not telling me what's really going on. I assume that whatever is going on in your heart that's important, you'll share with me. And you're not going to keep me in the dark and delude me. And I'm going to be able to wake up one day and you're going to kind of run off in the opposite direction. Done some huge, like, nonsense move. That you're going to keep me abreast of what's going on so that we can troubleshoot together, stay ahead of the curve. And it's worked, yeah. It's worked. Yeah, it's in a lot of ways, today I tried to, I don't know if you guys picked up on it, I doubt you did, because it was a little sophisticated, but I tried to model the idea of vulnerability by speaking to you guys in a very vulnerable way about how difficult it is being a teacher and being betrayed and letting your guard down. And the kind of people you meet. I tried to speak in a very real way, which demonstrated some humility myself and some vulnerability myself by giving you guys a little insight into my world, which if I did it right, then you sure felt empathy towards me and a desire to reciprocate. Even if you didn't notice what I was doing, it would have naturally created that. All All right, I'm called back. Don't tell me if you're done.